believe I messed that up. Hello and welcome to Fender Play Live. I'm your host, Eugene Edwards, and we have a really fun episode today. We're going to be talking about two artists who made a significant impact on rock and country music, maybe more than you realize. We're talking about Sister Rosetta Tharpe and Mother Maybelle Carter. We're going to dig into their techniques and the styles that you can still hear today in modern music. We've got two very exciting guests today. So that's right, I said two guests. So let's get to it. Helping us through today's journey is our trusted friend, Dr. Molly Miller, and a newcomer to FPL, Mona Tavakoli. Ladies, hello.
Hi.
Hey.
Look at that. Look at that set.
Gorgeous.
It's like, do you guys overtake that house that Robert De Niro lives in Heat? Because it looks really cool.
Yes.
We're also joined, we're also joined by the one, the only, the strange, the curious man, known as Dylan Caligiuri.
Mm. Hello. Hello, world. Hello.
again, he sounds like an alien sometimes. Dr. Molly Miller is a guitarist for the Molly Miller Trio, and she's also chair of the Los Angeles College of Music and plays with Jason Mraz, where I believe she met Mona. She met Mona there, who's a percussionist and is co-director and co-founder of the Rock and Roll Camp for Girls in Los Angeles. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. I can speak from hearing you guys at Soundcheck. The audience is in for an absolute treat this evening. I can't wait to get to the tunes. But before we get there, tell us what you're playing. Yeah, talk about gear here. Molly, you first.
Okay, so I got two guitars here. I got this Tele Ultra, which will be played the second half of the set with a very fun Chiquita banana sort of strap, just in case you were wondering. Thank you, Copperpiece. And then this is a Stratocaster. I think I think both of these on the show before, but this Strat I got when I was in seventh grade. And I've taken it with me all over the world. And yeah, it's one of my trusted guitars.
Fantastic. Can't wait. And what amp are you going through, if I may ask?
Fender Princeton Reissue, a 1965 reissue. This is my go-to amp for pretty much everything. Wow. I feel like it's part of my sound.
Interesting. And Mona, tell us what you'll be playing. And I think you should have a lot of pride in it, from what I understand.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. This is my signature cajon that I designed with Latin Percussion, and it's called the MT Box. Those are my initials, MT, Mona Tavakoli, and it's also an empty box. Thank you for taking it with me, Eugene.
I see what you did there, Mona.
Thank you.
Well, can you sample your signature cajon for us, please?
Sure. And I'm using some Vader cajon brushes to go with it. And I've got my El Sabor hand cymbal. Thank you so much to all my sponsors.
Wow.
And Molly, can you show off on that Strat and that Princeton for a minute for us, please? Front pickup, I assume.
Lovely. Yeah.
Lovely, lovely, lovely. I know that Dylan's playing his family heirloom Telecaster from the early 70s with a B-bender, and I've got my Frankenstein Stratocaster from 1999, 2000, somewhere thereabouts. But enough of that. Let's get to it. If you have any questions about either of the artists that we're talking about today, drop them in the comments, and we have two experts here to answer them. So let's start with Sister Rosetta Tharpe. Can we hear a tune? Maybe we can start the show off with some playing in her style, and then we'll kind of break down the techniques going on there.
Sick. Well, let's do it.
Thank you. actually down by the riverside, which is on the Fender Play side. If you want to learn the basics of that tune, so let's talk about this. Tell us a little about Sister Rosetta.
Yeah, Sister Rosetta Tharpe was born to cotton picking parents and then moved with her family up to Chicago, where she was a member of the Church of God in Christ, where she quickly became a superstar there. She was like performing and traveling throughout the church, playing guitar, singing, playing piano. And she was a natural performer, very charismatic. Went to New York City, and that's where she started playing, like mixing gospel and secular music, music from the church, music from life, playing with people like Duke Ellington, Lucky Millinder, and then like creating her own sound and like setting the foundation of rock and roll, doing some crazy things on the guitar, things that we think of other people as doing. But she was like playing double stops and slides and really setting the foundation of rock and roll guitar, which we can hear from a lot of people that we think of the founders as of rock guitar playing. You know, we talked about, like, Mona and I were talking about this, like Little Richard, whose first performance was outside of the church, was on Sister Rosetta Tharpe's stage.
Dang. Mm.
Wow. Maybe we can do one of those and then get even deeper into her style. And maybe I have a feeling you'll be able to hear Little Richard's influence, or how he was influenced by Sister Rosetta Tharpe in his music.
I think so. And now, just in terms of timeline, we could talk about how she was a pioneer to the rock and roll generation. Of course, the bulk of her recording, I mean, she did all that important work in the 30s, the 40s.
Exactly that time period, 30s and 40s. So, you know, you think the beginning of rock, you think like 50s, but mm-hmm. Rosetta was doing this in the 30s and 40s and like playing the guitar in such a different way. And I think it had a lot to do with just like mixing of genres and just like being forward thinking, being mm-hmm. like, you know, like, what can I do with this instrument? What are the things I can do? And she was such a powerful person that it just like came out on her instrument.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, rock guitar, you think like power, big excitement, charisma. And I think that's what I think of with Rosetta. And that's what I think of with rock guitar playing.
And let's talk a little more about the techniques that she pioneered. You mentioned double stops, double stop bends.
Yeah. Double stops.
Sounds familiar.
Slide. She'd a lot of times, like, I feel like a very iconic Sister Rosetta Tharpe thing would be like. So I did that. Triplets, like the butter, da 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 da, that kind of thing. You know.
I have to say, Molly, I've noticed every time you've played on this show, you always have a. There's always string slides going in. Did you get that from Sister Rosetta, or?
She is
directly,
like,
or
I like my guitar playing changed when I got deep into her. Like, like when I started studying her music and transcribing her playing, I was like, I was so inspired, and I feel like so many things clicked for me then. Like the way she played the instrument and just like owned it. So yes, definitely, my playing is very influenced by Sister Rosetta Tharpe.
And how about her tone, her guitar tone?
It's interesting. A lot of the times when she was playing, she actually tuned a minor third down. So like I'm in standard and E.
Oh, wow.
So like that's an E chord. But when she strummed, it was actually a C sharp instead of an E, which I think gave it also this like big bottom sound too. And yeah, which helped with the bends, made it easier to bend.
Yeah.
Yeah. But back then the strings would have been heavy gauge flat wound. So that does help out. And tell me, before you play another tune, her stage presence.
Oh my God. Have you seen some live footage? Yes.
Well, yeah, we're lucky that there is a lot of footage of Sister Rosetta, so we actually get to study the game film, if you will. So, if for those that haven't seen her, but what can you describe her? And what did the rock and rollers get from her?
Larger than life. It was like she would do this thing. Also, like one other thing, talking about like moves. She did this thing called the windmill that people think of like Pete Townsend as pioneering, but she would do where you're like. She was jumping around stage, like even at the end of her life, I was like read someone's account. At the end of her life, she was diabetic. So she had one leg and she'd like get up on one leg and be jumping around playing the guitar. Like she was a natural showman and loved just to like she had the audience in the palm of her hand. She was like, oh, I, you know.
Yeah, she made it. There was one of my favorites of hers is she would like hold a sustained bend and then her strum hand arm, she would move it around as if that was conducting the move. And Hendrix did that a lot. So you'd see this. She would move, and you'd be watching this hand when really all the work is doing over here. But it was always like there was always something going on when she performed, and when it was showtime, it was showtime. And Sister Rosetta did not mess around. And obviously the very, very dynamic, excitable Little Richard. You mentioned his first show outside of the church was on her stage. Can you place a sample of Little Richard and see if we can kind of pick up on you know what he was getting from her? Fantastic. Nice, a kind of a swampier version of Tutti Frutti right there. Very, very exciting. Thank you, Mona, for singing that. And then you also, just go into more music, mention Chuck Berry, and we talked about the double stops. Can we hear a little bit of that?
Totally. I'll play it, and then let's talk about it. Because pay attention to, like, some of the guitar techniques I'm using.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're very Sister Rosetta Tharpe, and all these people are talking about Chuck Berry founding rock and roll guitar.
Yes. After.
Okay.
He was actually part of an evolution, and she was before
talk
that.
About it. Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk about that. What is that? I mean, it's so iconic. That guitar part that they use it in Back to the Future as to facilitate, like, well, this is what rock and roll sounded like at this time. And so tell us about this and Sis Rosetta and that intro.
Yeah, I mean, you hear a lot of the things we were just talking about, the double stops, the slides, you know, sliding into notes, the double stop bend. And I think, like, the attitude. Mona, like, told me a really cool quote I never heard before.
Yeah, I was reading up on Sis Rosetta Tharpe and Chuck Berry and everything, and Chuck Berry once said his whole career was one long Sis Rosetta Tharpe impression.
Oh.
I mean, that's amazing.
Yeah.
And true.
And accurate. Yeah. Yeah. Take it from him. Wow. That's a great quote. I wasn't aware of that one. That's fantastic. We have a question from Matt B, who's watching on YouTube. Matt asks, as an early pioneer of using distortion and her personal connection with the tunes in performance, what influence do you think she had on Jimi Hendrix?
I mean, yeah, like you can, when I think of Jimi Hendrix, I think of all the, like, you know, the double stop, but, you know, and he did so many of those double stop bends and double stops in general. I think that's definitely one. And also, I don't know if it's directly from Sister Rosetta, but if you think of them on stage as these super dynamic performers, you can't keep your eyes off of that, like, knew that they had it and knew how to use it.
Showmanship or showwomanship in Sister Rosetta's case. Real quick, Dylan, over there in your corner here, we mentioned some techniques here. What lessons do we have on the site that might help people get into Sister Rosetta's groove?
Yeah, I mean, this stuff is great, right? It's so if you're just starting out and you want to veer off path just for a second, if you're brand new to it, you might try sliding first, because that's something that's pretty accessible in the beginning. We've got an intro to sliding class. Course. And then for double stops, it starts to get really intense because we've got twangy double stops, you know, the type of the, I don't know if you guys can hear that. And then there's also bluesy, like much like what Molly was playing today. So we actually have those delineations by sound. So if you want to try it on those two tracks, you can. And there's pretty much every topic we've dug into today on the site. So you might check them out to dig a little bit deeper.
No one has any excuses not to play like Sister Rosetta. No.
Right.
So, and obviously, actually, Molly, if you don't mind, can you break down a double stop real quickly? So,
Yeah, two notes at once is like, and then that's one part of a double stop, but double stop with hammer-ons, like, where you, one note is being played and the other note, or two notes are being played and one of the notes from that is getting hammered on at the same time. Mm-hmm. So I just like do one hit.
There you go. Oh, that's very Sister Rosetta right there. Yeah. Put the arm up and command attention. I love it. Now, let's start with some other artists that cite her as an influence. There, Molly, there was you mentioned Bob Dylan when we were talking earlier.
Yeah, Bob Dylan has a because Sister Rosetta Tharpe, like some of this iconic footage of her, one, mm-hmm. some of it's from the 60s when she did this like blues revival tour in Europe, and she played in the UK, and she like jumps out of this like, I feel like it's like a horse and carriage, but maybe I'm, is that right? I don't know if I'm like fantasizing now, but yeah. She like jumps out of some sort of moving something. Uh-huh. She walks on stage and she's like wearing this like beautiful like church dress, uh-huh. and puts on her guitar and just like goes for it. But Bob Dylan said, he was like, the quote is basically something like so many young English boys picked up the guitar because they saw Sister Rosetta Tharpe play that day or that tour.
Uh-huh. Tour.
Totally. So like it goes, you can hear it through the people like Jerry Lee Lewis, Little Richard, Chuck Berry, Elvis, St. Vincent, who I know is on the site. And mm-hmm. even today, like yeah. Brittany Howard.
Totally.
Right. And then what about modern artists like Bonnie Raitt too? I think Mona, you met Bonnie Raitt, yes?
I did. When I was on tour with Jason Mraz in Australia, and we ended up playing this small festival in a town called Deniliquin in Australia. And it was really small, like a really intimate festival, and mm-hmm. I got to stand in front of the barricades, security barricades, and watch Bonnie Raitt, you know, and just like stare up at her nostrils, and it was glorious.
It is glorious, yeah, that's right. Many people don't know that. Awesome. And you mentioned Brittany Howard. Everybody at home, get a seatbelt because you're in for a treat here. Can we hear a song that's on the Fender Play site, an Alabama Shakes tune? And Brittany makes pretty direct allusions to Sister Rosetta in costume, in gear. And let's check out that reference in music. I'm going to cede the floor to you guys. Thank you.
Yeah.
Woo! Yes.
A pop.
Oh yeah, Mona Tavakoli.
I warned the people that something big was about to happen. I warned the people. That's an FPL highlight for sure.
I've got a lot of empty boxes at my house. None of them sound like that at all. That's incredible. Not a one.
That's right. That's right. That's fantastic. Thank you so much, Mona. What a tremendous performance.
Right. I know. Honestly. Well, like her voice. Beautiful. And then like we were talking about this earlier, it's like, how are you 14 like instrumentalists in one? Like, which is, I'm just like, how are you doing so much? It's such a big, beautiful sound.
Yeah,
we're friends.
But I'm not saying that because we're friends. I'm saying that because it's true.
What's the tip there, Mona? What's the tip? Projecting confidence, what is it?
You know, I think in those moments when I'm in the music, especially playing with somebody who's so musical too, there is a submittal. There is a submittal to the thing. Mm. And so we were in, like, I don't know, I want to say a water slide together, which is not anything I've ever said in my life.
Yeah.
Like, go with it.
Just run with
the
metaphor,
bro. We're on a water slide. We're raging waters in San Dimas. Yeah. Never been there.
Love it.
And I don't know, it feels really safe. And to be honest, I never go that big in singing. I'm usually a backup vocalist.
Oh.
But Molly trusted me to like own that, and I was like, "Yeah, baby."
Well, we're all grateful that she did. So thank you so much. So, we have another subject here. So Sister Rosetta Tharpe, clearly a pioneer of rock and roll music. Yeah. But let's move on to another a pioneer of another hugely important genre, and that's country. What can you tell us about Mother Maybelle Carter's role in music history?
Oh man, she did so much. Another fun quote. I heard it be said that Mother Maybelle Carter, everything country has Mother Maybelle Carter's fingerprints on it. Mm. She was a part of this group, the Carter family, that is one of the first country bands. Before it was like hillbilly music, not really country. And she helped establish the genre, changed the way the guitar was played, did this thing called the Carter Scratch, added instrumental breaks, helped guitar become a lead instrument. Mm-hmm. So we can show you some of those things.
Just to give an idea of the time period, the country first heard the Carter family starting in 1927, a very, very historic session called the Bristol Sessions, where they put out an ad for people to come in from all these rural parts of America. And I think it was like $25 or maybe $50 a song, which was huge money. But wow. you had to get your way to Bristol. And A.P. Carter, Sarah, and Maybelle Carter were part of those sessions. Really, two major stars come out of those sessions. One is Jimmy Rogers, and then the other is the Carter family. And we start to get those records on the air by 1928, and the Carter family becomes this huge, huge success. So when we say the beginning, we're talking about also the beginning of recorded music being distributed. Yeah. And the Carter family is a huge part of how the industry, the actual industry part of it, of all of this, helps it gets kickstarted that way. So just to kind of, and so it's easy to say, like, everybody heard those records. Everybody heard Maybelle's guitar playing, and we'll talk about what they heard. And tell me about some of the guitar techniques that she pioneered, Molly.
Yeah. So maybe we'll do instrumental breaks first, because that'll be fun. So
okay.
Can I do that?
Yeah. Yeah. It's great.
Okay. Because there's a few things she did. Instrumental breaks where you like are playing some music, then there's a stop, and an instrument gets to be featured like this.
Right, so we...
I loved you hanging at the end, but I was like, yeah, so it's like that.
Yeah, we did it.
A rest qualifies as a riff, doesn't it?
Yeah, I'm still actually about to start going into my instrumental break now.
That was a joke.
Oh, no. We're perfect.
You're perfect. We're perfect. Go ahead.
So far, so good. So instrumental breaks, and we first hear those in country music on Carter record families. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Totally. See. Yeah. What I've read is they were one of the first groups to do this and make it a thing. So like starting to bring guitar to the front of like as a lead instrument. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, and then the famous Carter scratch. What is that? And can you show it to us?
Yeah, Carter scratch is when you're playing melody and chords at the same time. So something like this. Yeah, that was kind of mm-hmm. sloppy, but there we go, like that. So the melody's happening below, and the chords are happening above. And Maybelle's thought to have pioneered that.
Yeah, well, she certainly, of course, her playing that on those records, certainly, like all of a sudden, that's what country guitar playing is now. There was it set that template, and everything had to, all players had to respond to it or answer for it at some point, which is pretty impressive, really. That's a huge influence. It comes like a wave, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah. I forget which member of Flatt and Scruggs said this. I think it was Earl Scruggs, though, that he's like, everyone always tries to do the Carter scratch, but no one can do it like Maybelle. It's mm-hmm. like this iconic thing. He's like, and no one can do it like Maybelle.
Right. Right. Yeah. And they took their mistakes and they developed their own styles, really, from Joe Mafis, Chet Atkins. A couple weeks ago, we had Chris Scruggs on here talking about a lot of players. Cool. And we actually, that's a whole subset of country guitar players are those that do, now we call it hybrid picking or Travis picking, but it starts with that Carter scratch. So
yeah.
Tell us about who else did she influence, who else spoke about her?
Like everyone country, you know, you think Johnny Cash, who was her son-in-law, I feel like Dylan, but everyone who went through the Grand Ole Opry, which is everyone in country, cites her. She was the matriarchal figure there.
Can you, in fact, I think not a lot of people know Chet Atkins. The first time he arrives to Nashville is a part of her group.
Yeah.
She had gone solo, she left AP and Sarah kind of dipped out of the business, and she stayed with it. She stayed on the road all those years. She stuck it out and was a career woman in this sense. And a young Chet Atkins was her supporting guitar player, and she brought him to Nashville. And of course, he later would have a massive influence on, they call it the Nashville sound by the early 60s, was not just as a player, but as a producer. Can we hear of a performance of Wildwood Flower? You referenced that song, and this is, the, you know, so if you, can you play that for us?
Totally.
Thanks.
One, two, one.
Haircut.
Ha! Said that the other day, and I was like, "What are you talking about?"
You don't know the phrase?
No, now I do.
You've clearly not done a lot of barbering in, you know, over the years. Yes,
she never watched Who Framed Roger Rabbit either.
Oh, that's okay, true. So, good point.
Guilty.
So, Dylan, did you notice something when Molly starts to speak about you like you're not in the room, not in the Zoom? You started playing. Pure Carter scratch stuff, and then when you went for your solo, I heard tons of Sister Rosetta.
Yeah,
did you catch it, Dylan?
Absolutely. And you know what? If anybody watching this is interested in the stuff that Molly was just doing, and it feels like it's way up there, check out bass note strum, mm-hmm. alternate bass note strum, and sweeping, because there's a little of these. There's also, I want to mention, there is a Dylan Cal scratch, but we'll go over that on a different episode.
Whoa!
But there, yeah, it's a totally different thing, but no. Anyways, but yes, check those different lessons out, especially bass note strum.
That's wait, what's the sweeping intro thing? You mentioned this word sweeping, and then you interrupted yourself.
Molly, show him. You were doing some rakes in there.
That kind of thing?
Yes, absolutely. She was raking across there, sweeping.
I can do, it's actually, just there's a couple ways to do that. You could do it with just the pick, but I actually liked the hybrid picking, which you mentioned earlier, where I'm using my pick and my fingers. Yeah.
And Dylan, do we teach that?
We do. We have hybrid picking exposés.
Oh,
yes,
cool.
You get to learn everything more than you wanted to know.
Okay, let's get to another tune. What other song do you have in the Maybelle Carter category for us?
Another woman who was influenced by Maybelle Carter, a part of the Grand Ole Opry scene, Patsy Cline. We're gonna do a Crazy, which I know is on Fender Play.
Fantastic chord changes on this one.
And great material on Fender Play. So many benefits. Hybrid picking.
It's okay, Mona. You got the gig.
She said
I'm just kidding. I'm teasing. Please. No.
Okay. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, A.
Absolutely lovely.
Lost my headphones.
I know. You get into it. That was great. I know you couldn't hear it, Molly, but it was awesome.
Okay. I don't know what happened.
It was like Mona was saying, you submitted to the moment and things happen. And it was fantastic. It just shows how live we are actually too. You can't redo that. And quick trivia, Mona, who wrote that song?
Willie Nelson.
Willard.
Fantastic. Well, thank you so much for gracing us with all your talents. Now, it's astounding that two people could have such an influence on so many generations of musicians, obviously. Can you leave us with some final thoughts regarding the role of these two women in music history?
God. There's like so many elements. Like I think the line I like, she's like, our hero's hero, which is pretty heavy. Like I can't imagine what guitar would be without these women making guitar lead instrument and all the innovative techniques they did. And also I think like as a female musician, they paved a path for, you know, female musicians to make it a lot easier for us.
She's basically the Sheila E. of guitar.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah.
Bold statement.
Bold statement. Yeah. Wow. Shots fired. Well, thank you so much for this. Now, we're going to now to this. And again, everybody out there watching, I'm assuming they're just flipping out. And what an incredible, it all came with the price of admission, folks. It's a stunning, stunning performances. Let's get to some homework. And Molly, you came up with some things that tie into today's subject. So for the beginners out there, and Dylan, I'm going to have you demonstrate. Try strumming through Will the Circle Be Unbroken?
Ah, yes. Very basic and very simple.
Very simple for the beginner. Just get those chords for Will the Circle Be Unbroken, an old traditional country song that, in fact, Willie Nelson ends all of his concerts. That's part of the medley at the end of every show is Will the Circle Be Unbroken. And everybody, he grabs people from the audience and from side stage.
You could join Willie.
Yeah, everyone's welcome to come up and sing with Willie. For the intermediate, try some double stops. Oh, Dylan.
Maybe a little less erratic, but you know, you'll be able to do it. It'll come up. It'll come back.
And for the advance, and this should be in everybody's toolbox at this point, the intro to Johnny Be Good. Dylan. Yes.
This works great at bar mitzvahs, weddings, anywhere.
Impress your parents with it too.
Or yeah, at your parents' high school prom 30 years prior to when you were alive. Yeah, get yourself in the picture, folks. Okay, let's get to the giveaway. Dylan, it's all yours, buddy.
What a fantastic show. Good gosh.
We know.
I was in a trance. Oh, especially the last song, closing it out with Crazy.
Crazy. Yeah, that was crazy.
That was fantastic.
Was that just Sammy Davis Jr.?
Well, I wanted him to have a voice in this as well.
Why not? Okay.
For anybody that doesn't see the show every week, we have a fantastic giveaway at the end of every show. It's called the Fender Play Giveaway. It's a weekly giveaway where Fender Play users are automatically entered to win. So you're already entered to win if you belong to Fender Play. There's the fantastic news. And you get to pick, if you're chosen, from guitars, amps, basses, ukuleles. There's no Snoopy harps or anything like that, but there's a lot of stuff in there. You'll see. And so do you guys want to hear who won this week?
Yes, we do. And by the way, Dylan, time out. We're going to have to do those dog and pony lap drum roll things. We have a percussionist. We can do an actual
percussion.
Proper drum roll. So, Mona.
Attention!
Yeah. Huh. See what she's doing there? See,
it's funny.
Because she has a cajon, but she's not using it. She's doing it on her lap anyway.
It's irony. It's percussion irony.
Oh, there it is. Go ahead, Dylan.
Gary D! Gary D! Gary!
Way to go, Gary D. Way to go. Congrats to you, Gary. Enjoy your new guitar, bass, amp, whatever it is you choose. And Dylan, what else do you have for everybody else?
New songs on the site. It's a thing. It happens all the time. But we have new full songs. So you get to learn the entire thing. I mean, if the singer sneezes, it's in there. You're going to know
it. Yeah, we'll give you a lesson on that.
That's right. Mm-hmm. So let's see. Maybe you guys will recognize this one. That's right. Nirvana's. Nirvana's Lithium. It wasn't Willie Nelson's.
My favorite chord progressions right there, verse.
Yes. Kills me. Another one. Okay, so it's My Girl. So these are like my junior high
jams. Wait a minute.
They might be your...
Dylan? You want to check your notes there, buddy? I believe that was About a Girl.
About a Girl. Gosh, you know... They're both such influential songs. You know what they I mean? Are.
Or we have About a Girl by the Temptations. Maybe, I don't know. We'll check the site.
Yeah, you could do both.
Yeah, you can do both. Okay, well, thank you so much for that, Dylan. I want to also thank, in a big, big way, Molly for coming back to the show, and Mona for joining us for the first time. It certainly will not be the last. Now, we want to hear what you have coming up, but I think before we let you go, can we have you play just a couple more minutes of anything off the top of your head, the two of you?
Okay. Yeah? We'll do a quick little thing.
Well, yeah.
Oh, boy.
One.
I'm putting you on the spot.
Okay, we're going to do our best. One, two, three, two, two, three.
Thank you so much. Just put you on the spot, and you guys aced it. You clearly earned the right to free plugs. Do you have anything to plug, you guys? I know, Molly, you have an album coming up soon, yes?
Yeah, that actually, we just played a song from it. That was a song called Spry. That was my first single. I just put out my second single. Third single's in a few weeks. On April 23rd, it comes out, and Mona and I will actually be playing a drive-in show in Anaheim with Jason Mraz then.
Wow.
We're really excited.
Oh,
we got
fun.
A weekend of shows with Jason. Check that out. Yeah, my record's coming out in June.
Amazing.
Mona?
Yeah, thanks for asking, Molly. I'll be at the drive-in show with Molly. It was just Persian New Year. I did that already, but you were talking about future stuff. It's Rock and Roll Camp for Girls. If you're interested in making space for girls to feel good about themselves and play music and express themselves, go to werock.la. Check it out. We're going to do summer camp this year. Not sure if we're going to be able to do it in person, but please check that out. And RainingJane.com. What else?
Well, on it, I've done the Girls Rock Camp. I've been a part of it as a volunteer, and it is freaking incredible. So if you are a woman, or if you have a daughter or kid, like really, it's so incredible and so inspiring.
It should be said, the 21st century needs a couple of pioneers in some genres, and they'll probably come from your camp. I hope they do. So thank you so much, everybody. And to everybody watching, thank you for tuning in. I want you to keep safe, keep practicing, and we'll see you next week at the same time and same place. And we're going to groove out on a G chord, courtesy of Mona. Get us started here. Go ahead.